Good afternoon. First of all, I hope you are all safe, confined or not confined. I'm very happy to be here and to talk about nanodiffraction at ID 11. I'm gonna share my screen. I hope you see it. Okay. So here we start. I will talk about the case of asbestos fibers, which is a very promising case for doing nanosingle crystal diffraction. Single crystal diffraction is a very old technique. As the first experiments that have been performed at synchrotron sources are now almost 40 years old. And as far as we are talking as an old technique as a single crystal diffraction, you also are aware of the fact that a lot of in-house X-ray sources have been developed and implemented, and people can perform experiments at their own lab. But there are still a lot of scientific cases and a lot of challenges that needs and require synchrotron light. In particular, there are very small crystals that cannot be measured in in-house labs, and there are as well some samples that are not scattering well. There are weakly diffracting crystals that are suitable cases for this kind of experiments that I will talk about later. So as Brian introduced, I work at the SRF, and in particular I work at ID11, that is the material science beamline, where we perform several kind of experiments. ID11 has two experimental hatches and three different experimental stage. So we have EH1, which is the hatch meant for large heavy experiment with moderate focusing. You can see it's located here, and it's located in the experimental hall of the ESRF. And then we have in the extension building the EH3, where we range from micro to sub micro focusing. We can go down to 150-200 nanometers, where we have two experimental stations that you will see in the next slides. So single crystal diffraction, as I was mentioning before, can be performed already in EH1, where we can mount a sample stage onto the Huber diffractometer, and we can provide several temperatures. It's nice for doing in situ single crystal diffraction. Indeed, we can host several sample environments, and we can range from hot temperature by using a gas blower furnace, and as well we can go down in temperature using a cryostream or cryostat. In terms of beam sizes into this hatch, we can condition our beam by using the in-vacuum transfocator that is located upstream in the optics hatch. And we can go down to a beam size that is 50 by 50 micron. But what I will be talking about today, it's more about EH3, and where we have as well another instrument that is the 3D XRD station, where we can go down to the micron size. But today I will focus about this other station that is the nanofocus station, where we can go down to 150 nanometers, thanks to some linear silicon compound refractive lenses. If you want to see more in detail the instrument, this is it. So basically, you see in the middle of the picture our sample stage, and you can see that there are several telescopes and microscopes, because we are talking of a sample station that is hosting really small samples. So this means that to align them, you require several steps of alignment. Basically start from an image, an optic image from a telescope or a microscope, and then you go down and you look for better precision for the alignment by using imaging cameras, absorption signal of the sample, or the diffraction signal itself of the sample. So if you have a look at the sample stage, working with a small beam means also being accurate with the motor's position and being able to have precise movement of the sample. So if we remove the aluminium cover of our sample stage, what we find from the bottom to the top is a rotation stage that has a very ultra low error motion, that is below 20 nanometers. On top of it, we have a translation stage, an XYZ stage, that of course allows us to move quickly the sample also in a very precise way. And on top of it, we have an hexapod with 10 millimeter travel range on top of the center of rotation. So if you assemble all these pieces together, this is what you basically get. And as far as I told before, we are talking a very small beam, also the sample is small, and the sample preparation has to be as more accurate as possible. In particular, when we work on the nanoscope station, there are several kinds of sample preparation, and here I'm just mentioning three. In particular, for single crystal, I tend to use micro loops, and they are very easy to find and buy, and as far as you can find on the market, several sizes with several mesh sizes. You can basically find and stick on top of it whatever small crystal you have. Then you can use some kinematic mountings and mount that, installed it on the nanoscope station. As well, you can use TEM grids. There are some users that are using this system for measuring their sample. The good thing is that with the TEM grids, you can pre-characterize or post-characterize your sample after the synchrotron data collection. So this is very convenient. The only thing that is not convenient by using this TEM grid is that you cannot allow a 360 rotation of your sample. And as well, you can use some samples that are prepared by FIB. These are normally good because you can have a sample that has the shape that you prefer, and if some platinum is deposited on top of it, makes it easier when you are finding them in the beam. As well, you can have several detectors. In the picture before, you could see that there was mounted a Sensicam, but we also can provide a fluorescence detector that we can use either to collect data in the same time we are collecting diffraction data, but we can also use it for just alignment purposes, and Freelon cameras. So you will see that in the next month, Freelon camera will change. We won't have a Freelon camera anymore, but we will have an Eiger detector. So I will talk about this later. And just prior to perform any experiment, we want to be sure that we have the correct beam size and that the sample is aligned. And if you are wondering how we get such a small beam size, it's because onto this station there are some compound silicon compound refractive lenses that are mounted in order to get such a small beam size. If you can see in, for example, picture A, you can see that as one minus the rational part of delta, where delta is basically the decrement of the refractive index, and it's smaller than one, a collecting lens for X-rays should have a concave shape. So basically, you can see that a CRL can be basically made by a number of cylindrical holes that you put close together, and you basically put them in a row along the optical axis, and like this you can focus the X-rays at a distance that is n times shorter compared to a single lens. So you basically stack them together. We have a way of measuring the beam size on our station that is basically scanning across a wire, a gold tungsten wire, where there's from 3 to 5% of gold deposited onto the surface of this wire. And by scanning it through its fluorescent signal or through a grain of gold deposited on the surface, we are able to fit the edge of this scan and realize how big is the beam that we got. Is it also possible to combine these lenses with a vacuum transfocator that is placed upstream in our optics hatch in order to have more flux? But like this, the beam size tends to get a bit bigger. And as I was mentioning before, before performing any single crystal experiment or any diffraction experiment, we want to be sure that our sample is well aligned in the beam. And for this reason, we use this telescope or an overhead microscope. And we perform a final centering of the sample after having optically aligned the sample previously by using the absorption signal of the sample or the fluorescence or its diffraction signal. And of course, we want to be sure that the sample is into the center of rotation. So when I arrived to ID11, I had quite experience with asbestos fibers that were the subject of my PhD thesis. And I thought that that was the right place to measure some other fibrous samples. In particular, in the next slides, I will talk about a fibrous ferrite that comes from British Columbia, from which the structure was... there were, let's say, some debate in literature whether the structure was monoclinic or orthorhombic. You might ask why it is important to have a correct crystallographic description of this kind of sample. So the reason is that because we need a reliable structural model, because these fibers can be harmful. These are not yet considered asbestos fibers, they are natural fibers. But it is important to perform in vivo and in vitro tests just to assess if they are toxic or pathogenic. And having the good structure from as a starting model, it's something that we aim to. So as I was mentioning before, there are several structures existing in literature that describe the ferrite. And in particular, there is one orthorhombic in the space group IMMM, and another one in the monoclinic group P2-1/N. So basically, there are some silicon oxygen tetrahedra, and whether these tetrahedra, whether there are these TOT angles of 180 degrees, just when these angles are not 180 degrees, you see that some mirror planes disappear, and you see that the symmetry of these materials decrease. So as well, ferrite is also complicated because it frequently contains planar defect. And if you are collecting a powder diffraction pattern, you will see that the peak intensities and width of these peaks are also sensitive to this fall probability. As you can see in these pictures, there are really several kinds of defects, and by increasing the number of these defects, you can see that the intensity are, you see that the probability of this expansion, which are called sigma expansion, is false. You see, as far as they increase, your peak intensity are completely messed up. And another reason why ferrite is complicated, it's because its extra framework content is a variable. So these are the two ferrite cages. These are two cages. One is the ferrite cage that takes indeed the name from this material. And you can have different content inside. You can have in one cage magnesium, iron, or calcium. In the other, you can have sodium, potassium, and aluminium. So studying fibers is not so easy, because if you want to approach them from a single crystal diffraction point of view, and your beam is not so small, this pattern that you see here, this image that you see here, is what you basically get. So this is a real image that I took using a beam size that wasn't even so big. It was a couple of microns. And indeed, you can see that there are some spots coming from some single crystals, but you can also see that there are rings. So this means that these fibers normally bundle together, and it's very difficult to get only the signal from one clear and clean fiber. And if you want to approach them from a powder diffraction point of view, you can see that there are a lot of texture problem, and this because all the fibers are all oriented along the fiber axis, even when you stack them into a capillary. And you get a pattern that it's very difficult to analyze, especially if you want to get the structure from something that has already issues of textures and so on. So I decided that studying this kind of fibers was kind of interesting, and I decided to apply nanosingle crystal diffraction at ID11. What is unique at ID11 is the fact that we can perform single crystal at this very high energy. In this case, for example, I performed this experiment at 60 kV. That allows you to have a nice resolution for solving single crystal data. The sample was mounted on one of these supports that I was talking to you about before. So you can see that actually here there are two fibers, not one. And indeed, if I would use a beam that is bigger than a few couple of microns, I would not have a clean single crystal diffraction from this. So these two scans that you see here on the bottom are basically the scan at 90 degrees and 0 degrees that I performed across the sample that define the crystal size. So our crystal was a few microns. So by analyzing this data, by indexing and extracting intensities and eventually refining the structure, it turned out that I had some nice and clean single crystal data. I hope you can see here in these unwarped pictures that there are no extra peak that shows that the symmetry is lower than IMMM. And I found some extra framework content that was in line with the chemical formula. So basically, I could have just said, okay, I solved my crystal. This is it. I'm happy. It's in line with my chemistry. And I'm very happy about the data I collected. So here you can see some other details of the refinement and the single crystal extra content. But it happened that for these materials, I also had some high-resolution powder diffraction pattern collected at ID22 of the SRF in a capillary that was spinning at 787 RPM and that I prepared by grinding the crystals before and by putting them together in a capillary by using a capillary buoy. So I wanted really to be sure when I was collecting this powder diffraction pattern that there were no preferential orientation effect, because I knew that these materials were fibers and they would have tend to organize inside the capillary in a specific with a specific orientation. So what I decided to do, it was basically taking the structure I refined and solved by using single crystal and inputting it into my powder, high resolution powder diffraction pattern. And what I got, it was basically this fit that although it, for some of you it could seem satisfactory, for me it wasn't, because the RWP it was still high and I could see that some peak intensities were not matched. This was just by using a pseudo-void peak shape model. So I asked few people to perform some TEM of these fibers, and it turned out that actually there was some disorder. So I decided to use the information from the microscopy side as an input for my powder diffraction refinement into Topaz. And what I decided to do, it was adding I decided to add the information for the disorder just along these planes, but still the pattern was not improving. My RWP went below 15, but still it was not satisfactory. So what I've decided as a last chance was to use some preferential orientation to fit my pattern and using some spherical harmonics. And what I could see is that the RWP of my pattern started to have a more reasonable value. But most of the times, some people use preferential orientation just as a way to improve the fit, but with no physical meaning. And I wanted to be sure that this actually had a sense for me. So I wanted to be sure, does it really make sense? Is it really true? Can I trust this model? Is it really true that, my fibers inside the capillary are have an orientation or a texture? So I took again this capillary and I brought it back to ID11, where I told you before we performed several experimental techniques, and one of these is also phase contrast tomography. And I decided to take a picture of my capillary. And what you can see here, these are some slides in different direction of my capillary. You can start barely see that the fibers are oriented somehow. But if you analyze this with a more professional software that tomography people use as VG Studio Max, and color all the fibers that you find on the basis of the orientation, you can really see on the fourth picture that there's actually a strong orientation of these fibers inside the capillary. So, what I also done, I've decided to plot the three-dimensional six-order spherical harmonics for the preferred orientation correction of the ferrite fibers into the capillary. And what I can see from this plot is that there is a preferred orientation along the A direction of my along the A direction, as it was found from the phase contrast tomography. So basically these things were all in line, and as well I could see from the plot of the orientation distribution function coefficient for the correction of the preferred orientation of the ferrite fiber inside the capillary, that there is a direction that seemed to have a very high correction factor, was times 2.4, that confirmed that the 7.5 angstrom crystal axis, which is indeed the long direction, For this correction factor multiplies these peak intensities, meaning that only few crystals have the 7.5 angstrom axis perpendicular to the axis of the capillary. So I had two confirmations. One was basically crystallographic by using spherical harmonic approach, and the other one was by tomography. All of these basically to say that the structure I found with the nano single crystal experiment was correct, and it is possible that to use this technique to investigate very difficult samples such as natural fibers. Another take-home message from this story was that when you have a powder diffraction pattern, especially a high-resolution powder diffraction pattern that you cannot fit, You cannot lie. There is a reason why your peaks and your peak shape have this specific position or intensity. As well, what it helped me was to use complementary techniques. For speaking about fibers, there's another project that we are getting toward the end just these days. And it is the determination of a crystal structure of an asbestos fibers that has stayed into a human lung for 40 years. So thanks to the person that decided to donate the lung of a person that died of asbestosis, we've managed to find some fibers in his lung. This person was working in a mine where they were extracting asbestos, and we managed to find a fiber mounted on a support. It was really the moment where we found this fiber and managed to mount it on the support. We were very happy, I have to say, because it's not easy to go and fish for this kind of crystals. So what we wanted to do is to see if there were any changes into these fibers produced by the fact that this fiber stayed inside the lung. So what is really important for scientists is that there is still a step missing to understand, which is the mechanism that induces lung diseases such as mesothelioma or lung cancer. And so for us, the aim of this study was trying to understand first if something happens to the fiber inside the lung. For example, asbestos fiber in particular, these amphiboles have a lot of iron. And in the past, a lot of people have been wondering if it was the iron leaching into the lung tissue that was causing such inflammatory processes and then cancer. So what we've seen is that basically by collecting nano diffraction on this fiber, you can see that the fiber was really few microns. I don't know if I put a scan of it, but it's just a couple of microns thickness. This fiber is basically stable over time, and we also proved it for several parts of the fiber, on top of the fiber and on the center of the fibers. We did it in two different regions because sometimes there are a few things that develop on the surface of the fiber which are called asbestos bodies. So we wanted to be sure that in all the parts of the fiber decomposition was actually measured. And what we saw is that the structure that we found is the one of a namosite natural fiber, the one that you would find in the nature. So the fiber remained stable for over 40 years inside the lung of this person. And this has some consequences when you want to create a model that describe the toxicity of asbestos. And in particular, the fiber is very resilient, and this creates one process that is called frustrated phagocytosis from the macrophages inside the lung. So as you can see here, if you would have a fiber that it's short, it could be basically being eaten by the macrophage, but when you have a fiber like this that remains stable, it's very difficult to break from the macrophage, and this creates a lot of damage for the tissues and the initiation of some adverse effect that leads eventually to the development of cancer. So this for us not only gives some other scientific proofs for create a carcinogenic model, but as well it's an argument for the universal ban of asbestos fibers. So for what it concerns to fibers, this is all. And I also want to remind you that on our nanoscope station, we not only do nanofibers, we study a lot of other single crystals, and we also use other techniques. A promising one is the three-dimensional X-ray diffraction for polycrystalline materials on a grain-by-grain basis. So this is a recent example that have been published where a community of our users have studied the 3D microstructure around the thin whisker and its evolution during its treatment. So they use 3D XRD diffraction in order to reconstruct the shape of each grain and the local lattice parameters and grain orientation. So we use nanobeam not only for single crystals. And after this, just reminding you that in 2018, the SRF has been shut down, and in 2019, we had the upgrade of our machine. So you can see here in this picture some works that have been done in the tunnel for replacing and installing the new machine. So we saw our first photons on March 2nd at ID11. We clearly and definitely have more flux. And for what it concerns nanodiffraction, we are going to install in the next month an Eiger 4M detector that will allow us to go faster and have better quantum efficiency. We want to have afterglow and a really high count rate capabilities. So we are really happy and thrilled for having BIM back again. Currently we are in shutdown again, so we will see the BIM in a week time, roughly. So we are really excited about doing new science, and in particular using nanobeam. And last but not least, there are a few people I would like to thank. People from the Beamline and some collaborators that really made this work come true.